My name is Jonathan Moyer. I'm an assistant professor here at the Korbel School, and I'm the director of the Pardee Center for International Futures. I have a bit of a cold. You have to forgive me. In conjunction with the Center for Middle East Studies, another center here at the Korbel School, I'm very happy to co-host a presentation with former Prime Minister Jibril of Libya. Dr. Jibril earned a PhD from the University of Pittsburgh in 1985. He studied political science, strategic planning, and foreign policy. In 2007, Dr. Jibril was appointed the Secretary General of the National Planning Council in Libya, where he worked on a 2025 vision document. In 2011, Dr. Jibril joined the Libyan Revolution to lead the creation of an interim National Transition Council. In 2012, Dr. Jibril was elected president of the National Forces Alliance. At the Pardee Center, we're very excited to have Dr. Jibril here because he has a long and sustained interest in strategic planning. That's what we do as a center. We have large-scale, long-term, integrated assessment modeling platforms that allow different groups to better think critically about the long-term future. Dr. Jibril, Prime Minister Jibril, has a long history with this, so we're very excited to spend the remainder of the afternoon after this presentation with Prime Minister Jibril talking more about his interests in doing long-term strategic planning and forecasting in Gulf Cooperation Council states, as well as more broadly. So the structure of the event today will be that Prime Minister Jibril will come up and give a discussion for 10 to 20 minutes. At the end of that, he will be joined up here by Ambassador Christopher Hill, the Dean of the Korbel School. They will have a brief conversation. And at the end of that conversation, a discussion between Dr. Jibril and Ambassador Christopher Hill and the rest of you will be moderated and led by Professor Nader Hashemi, the director of the Center for Middle East Studies. So I think it's going to be a very exciting event today. Thank you all very much for coming. Don't forget to visit our websites and our Twitters and our Instagrams to socially network with us. And thank you to all the people who helped to facilitate this event today. Thank you very, very much. So with that, please join me in welcoming Prime Minister Jibril.
Oh, it's a big audience. I didn't expect that. Good afternoon, everybody. I would say it's both a pleasure and honor to stand here in front of you to listen to some words of experience about the future of our globe and to put the events of the Middle East, which took place late 2010, early 2011 perspective, and it's a global perspective. So in that context, I would like to extend a gratitude and thanks first to His Excellency Ambassador Chris, to Jonathan, the head of the RB Center for International Futures, and to Dr. Hashemi, who associated himself with this event, and to all those who took part in organizing this event and having me standing in front of you having those words. My talk is going to be focused mainly about general remarks. And then I'll put some focus on what's labeled as an Arab Spring, and specifically more focus in Libya. When I became associated with the World Future Society in 1987, and then established what's called Horizon 21 in the Middle East, composed of about 78 members of Arab futurists, the question of futurology was something new in the Middle Eastern context. We started some early practices, early training, and what's called the visioning process. I was part of the visioning process in Oman, and then we developed what's called Libya Vision 2025, in 2008. Unfortunately, that document did not see the light. It was not translated into concrete plans. What most of future scholars agree on, that three drivers in particular will shape the future of humanity. The first driver is demography. The world, as we speak today, exceeds 7 billion people, but by 2050, it's going to be exceeding 10 billion people. The second driver of history is this eternal marriage and integration between capital and technology. And it seems that the driver is irreversible. Unfortunately, technology today, and this happens for the first time in history, is far ahead of a human intellect. I was talking yesterday to about 500 undergraduate students and talking to them how this little mobile became a physical extension of you, and that you miss your mobile more than you miss your family. Your secrets, your data, everything, even your feelings, how they are expressed, became in that little box. Total dependency in technology. Not only this, we became almost lost in terms of intellect to make meaning and sense of what's going on in the world. We became just running after events, trying to understand what's going on. This alliance, our eternal alliance, which in my opinion is irreversible between technology and capital, has resulted in what's called the ultra-symbolic economy, where the speedy movement of capital between different stock markets become the bulk of the world or the global economy. The implication of this is very dangerous, because if we look at how the population is increasing exponentially, especially in Africa, which by 2050 will be approaching 2 billion people, and how most of world economies, including the economy of the United States and European economy, those industrial economies, are moving into service economy. Because of ultra-symbolic economy, the payback is so fast and so hefty, so lucrative. Then there is going to be a huge gap between the food needed to feed those mouths coming into existence because of the world population increase, and the transfer of world economy to service economy and ultra-symbolic economy. In my opinion, the core factor behind the fiscal crisis of 2008 was not what was labeled as a real state of problem and this kind of justifications given at that time for the crisis. I think, in my opinion, the real cause is that our structures, which were inherited after World War II, are totally irrelevant to this new world in shaping today. Knowledge is changing so fast. A new type of education is needed, so we move from access to knowledge to the management of knowledge. New skills are needed. Management of complexity, management of diversity, management of uncertainty, because things are moving so fast, changing so fast, we cannot even grasp what's going on. Therefore, what's been done here in this school is very important, how to come up with models that help us not only understand, but to predict what's going to happen. Because the strategy in the old sense, I would say, I hope I'm not exaggerating, it's not relevant anymore. Because when you talk about trend, for instance, trend needs two requirements: time and repetition of the event. So you can establish repetition across time. So you, established trend. This repetition thing doesn't exist anymore because events become so bumpy, up and down. Look at oil prices, for instance. Everything is so bumpy, so unpredictable. Therefore, the more we aggregate, the more generalized we come with our drivers and the interaction between those drivers, the more able we're going to be to grasp what's going on and predict what might happen. What if scenarios became more relevant than strategy in the traditional sense? That's why I was very excited to come here this afternoon and look at the model developed in this prestigious school. Having said that, especially the issue of population, why I am touching on this in particular? Because Libya and the North African coast is going to be either the connecting point between two civilizations, between Europe and Africa, or it's going to be the black hole where illegal immigration and refugees will threaten the national security of each single European country. Unfortunately, this took place 22nd of October 2011 in front of the Parliament of the European Union. I was warning them, please don't leave Libya. Mission did not finish. Mission is not accomplished. Mission is just about to start. Libya at that point was a stateless society, no institutions whatsoever. So don't leave it. The mission is needed now to help us rebuild our institutions, help us stand on our feet. للأسف, or unfortunately, that talk was not heard, was not listened to. My warning was, if we don't listen to this and do something about it, Libya is going to be the cradle of terrorism in the Middle East. You can go back to the record and review and go over those words word by word. Anyhow, Libya is 6 million people with vast amount of oil revenues, diversified natural base of resources. Libya is the potential of creating a real model of development, not only in North Africa, but in the whole of the African continent. What's taking place right now is the harvest and the output and the outcome of 40 years of rule, where the human resources were not prepared, were not educated enough, were not trained enough. We did not build our human resources in Libya. If you compare what's spent in education and health in Libya as compared to Tunisia and Jordan as a non-oil producing countries, you'll be surprised that both countries exceed Libya in their expenditures in both fields. Therefore, what's taking place right now is natural. And people say, look what took place, you know. Many people would legitimize Gaddafi's rule from the perspective of what's taking place right now, as a reflection, as a reaction to what's taking place right now. I would say that what's taking place right now is the biggest proof, biggest evidence that this uprising was way, way, way late in its happening. It was overdue. Should have happened at least 20, 25 years ago. At least would have prevented lots of those catastrophes that's taking place today. Libya, its tribal structure, oil resources, lots of money, complete absence of state authority, weapons all over the place, we have the recipe of a civil war. It was ready there. So what's taking place in Libya today is not a political struggle. It's not a political conflict as characterized by too many people, whether inside Libya or outside Libya. It's a conflict over natural resources, over money. If Libya was like Tunisia or Egypt, I would argue that most of those kids holding rifles on their shoulders today would have given up those arms and look for a job, for another source of income. Today, those rifles on their shoulders is their source of income. What's taking place in Libya is something like a tragedy that I hope in the near future will come to an end. But to come to an end, it needs first a Libyan will, not the international will. Because the international community cannot help us as Libyans unless we help ourselves first. That needs a Libyan bond. Libyans has to trust each other, has to think that the future is more important than the past. The past can't do anything to change it. What happened has happened, whether it was good or bad. But you have something to do about the future. Every Libyan today should think about the future of his kids. Even those militia leaders today came to the realization that what matters is the future, and they are looking for an exit. And this was not the case just 2-3 years ago. 2-3 years ago, everybody thought that he can do it by force. And I would claim that there isn't a single party, whether the Libyan army or the militias or the tribal leaders or political leaders, none who can dominate the whole Libyan territory by force. Therefore, there is no exit but consensus that Libyans should sit around the table and talk about the real problems that impede the restoration or bringing back the state back to our lives. The approach which was adopted by the United Nations, I think, was not the right approach. The United Nations is going by the book. I had too many rounds of talks with Bernardino Leon, and I was begging him. Libya is a unique case. We have no state. We have no state power. So power sharing is not relevant in the Libyan case. We have to establish a state power first before talking about sharing that power, because the power is with the militia leaders. It's not with the state. The most fragile element in the Libyan structure today is the government. And you all remember how Prime Minister Zidane was dragged on from his pajama while he was sleeping by a militia leader. Mr. Sarraj, who's appointed by the international community as Prime Minister, National Accord Government, he stayed about 5 months in Tripoli, but he stayed as a hostage. He could not do anything. That tells you who's the boss in Tripoli, who's the boss on the Libyan ground, on the Libyan territory. Those are the real players, four elements: militia leaders, political leaders, social leaders, and probably some of the followers of the previous regime who call for the future of Libya. They don't talk about bringing back Gaddafi days. If you bring those who are the real doers, comprising the Libyan scene today, talking about the real issues, how to collect those arms, how to reintegrate those kids into better options, how to turn them from being the problem into being the solution. Two, how to rebuild the army, how to rebuild the security apparatus in Libya, how to reactivate the judiciary system, how to accomplish the national reconciliation in Libya, and most importantly, how to reactivate the Libyan economy, because what we have today is militia economy, terrorism economy. We don't have an economy in Libya today. All the economy is focused basically on those militia leaders, their trades and all sorts of illegal trading. We discovered that there are no less than 28 Libyan cities which are totally safe, free of any types of militias. So we have no excuse for any government not to start reactivating the economy from the periphery instead of focusing on the center. So rebuilding the state from the periphery is an option, and it's an option that's available now, not tomorrow. So in seizing this opportunity today, I think everybody realized, all the elements in Libya realized that there is no way out but to sit around the negotiation table and to come to some sort of consensus. But not a consensus of the United States about sharing power, who's going to be the prime minister and who's going to be the foreign minister. No, that's not the issue. The issue in Libya is the what, not the who. What should be done to bring the state back to our lives? After we agree on this agenda, coming up with solutions to those problems, then we talk about forming the government, who's going to be qualified to implement this agreed upon agenda. Therefore, I'm talking to you today as a Libyan, saying that Libya will be back on its feet. Libya needs the support of the international community, but most importantly, needs the understanding and the support of the United States. The understanding of the United States first before its support. The United States is playing the leader of a world leader role. But to play that role effectively, you have to understand the situation from the perspective of the Libyans themselves, not from a regional perspective or from an international perspective. From a regional perspective, Libya is a threat to the national security to its neighboring country. Libya is a threat to the national security of the Europeans. From a global perspective or international perspective, Libya is a destabilizing spot that can export terrorism to anywhere in the world. In that sense, Libya is perceived from international and regional perspective. But from the perspective of Libyans themselves, who are the dominant forces who have a grassroots existence in Libya today, who can be potentially a strategic ally, who can rebuild Libya with our help in the next 10, 15 years to come? Because Libya has it all. All we need is a mutual understanding as Libyans and a mutual trust between us as Libyans. The international community can play the role of guarantor of our agreement, but it should not dictate the agreement itself, as it happened in Skhirat. What happened, the United Nations approach, an agreement which was concluded on 17th of September 2015, it was not a Libyan approach. It was a UN approach. Libyans just signed in. The Libyans should do it in their own. And the United States and the rest of the international community should be the guarantor of that approach as long as it serves the interests of Libya and serves the stability of Libya as a spot that, if stabilized, the whole Middle East will be in a better situation. Believe me, neither Tunisia nor Egypt will be stable unless Libya got stabilized. Because the source of terrorism, in terms of weapons, in terms of human resources, are coming from this black hole. That's why I started by talking about Africa, because Libya can be a barrier of development. We developed some sort of a model in Libya, talking about illegal immigration, how Libya can be a bridge of linking two civilizations. We tried to present a case where we can have some twinning between Libyan universities and European universities in Libyan soil. We can have a twinning between Libyan hospitals and European hospitals on Libyan soil. And we can have a twinning between Libyan banks and financial channels or financial institutions in Europe and Libyan soil. We can have renewable energy. But most importantly, Libya can be the hub of transformational training of those Africans to acquire them the necessary skills according to specific needs of the European economy in the next 30 years. Therefore, those Europeans will be wanted by each single European country. They are kicked out because they are unskilled labor. Because Europe, 2025, will be needing no less than 110 million skilled labor just to sustain its level of productivity today. Libya, Europe is shrinking. By the year 2050, it's going to be less 72 million people, and it's Asian continent. While Africa is expanding, and it's estimated according to the UN statistics that by the year 2050, no less than 360 million Africans, young Africans, will be marching north looking for jobs. That's how Libya is strategically the link. Libya is strategically the focus. It's in the vested interest of the Europeans and the international community in general to have Libya as a spot of stabilization, linking both continents, not a black hole through which terror and hell is touching on European shores. Africa has the potential. Africa today has 12% of the oil reserves, have 10% of the well-known natural gas resources, have 90% of the reserves of platinum in the world, 50% of the gold reserves in the world, 40% of the diamond reserves in the world. So we are talking about real treasure. 40% of the well-known natural resources in the world are in Africa. Africa is the future. And the window to Africa is Libya. Because north, east of Libya and west of Libya are populated country. Egypt is going to be 100 million by 2020. Algeria and Morocco combined is going to be 92 million. While Libya by 2025 is going to only be 8.1. So Libya is the spot. This is the importance of demography, how it's linked to technology, how it's linked to investment, how you can create a better life for our future generations. Having said those general remarks, I don't want to go into more details. I will leave it to the discussion, and I will give it to Jonathan, you know, if he want to welcome Ambassador Chris. Thank you very much for listening. Could I sit down?
Grab a seat here. And thank you very much, Dr. Prime Minister, for those remarks. You know, in our modeling, in 1950, 1 in 4 people were European globally. By 2050, 1 in 4 will be African. So it's quite an interesting transition. I'd like to invite Ambassador Christopher Hill up to engage in a conversation with Prime Minister Jibril. Thank you very much.
So what I thought I'd do is have a little conversation with Dr. Jibril, and then maybe we could open it up and people could also ask questions. Because Dr. Jibril, I know you've seen this with other audiences, but Americans are quite conflicted about what happened in Libya. There was, an effort to go in, and you recall this was the famous expression, leading from behind. So automatically, it became a kind of internal political issue. Is this how America should lead, et cetera? So it became Libya became just a very searing internal political problem in America. And then, of course, we had the terrible tragedy with our ambassador and the three other diplomats. So Americans are really quite conflicted. Did we do the right thing? Should we never involve ourselves in a place like Libya? And yet you've made a very compelling case for why Libya is a sort of key part of the region, and why, if we should remain interested in the world, and I think our country will be interested in the world, why we need to deal with issues like Libya. But you've also outlined a circumstance where you have all these sort of militia groups. I suspect they correspond to some tribal groups. But you've painted a picture, a very sad picture of a lack of institutions. So I guess I'd like to ask you, when did that lack of institutions start? Did it start with Gaddafi coming into power, or did it start with his leaving power?
Well, Gaddafi himself was obsessed with theory of anarchism, you know. He always say in his private meetings with some guests that most of political theories had the chance of being tried or implemented, you know, except anarchism, you know. So he was obsessed that anarchism might be the solution for humanity, where people, they don't need currency. They can just trade. You have some rice and I have some clothes. We can trade. You need the clothes and I need the rice. So we go back to our primitive.
He was quite an original thinker, wasn't he?
Yes.
I haven't heard this one before.
In that sense. So he started early in the game, probably since 1977, working and dismantling any institutions. You know. In terms of law, he was talking about the law of legitimacy of the revolution, not the normal law that we all know. And then talking about state of the masses, so the people rule themselves. People should possess weapons, wealth, and power. This is for the people. And he's not a ruler.
Yeah.
He's just the godfather. He's just an inspiration for those people, you know. Therefore, there isn't any institutions in the traditional sense of institution that can be held accountable in its performance, you know. There were cabinets. There is what's called Mu'tabar Sha'b al-Am, or the General Congress, the People's Congress. But in reality, Gaddafi was running the show, you know. He can change ministers instantly. He can change the theory by updating it. He can change the structure. Today we have, for instance, 22 governorates. Just 1 year, he reduces them, for instance, to 12. By his own decision, not based on necessity or studies, no.
Yeah.
Then he would go for the municipalities. Then he cancels the municipalities.
Yeah.
So the state, in terms of institution, was not stable for 42 years.
Yeah.
So you can say that there is institutional tradition or institutional history in the country. In that sense, when Gaddafi disappeared from the scene, we found us that we are a stateless society. There is no state in the sense. He dismantled the army early in the 80s, and early 80s, because his biggest fear was from the army, that a coup d'etat might be instigated by army officers. And he established what he called security brigades, headed by his sons as his relatives, you know, to protect the security of the regime, you know. And he discovered in the uprising of 2011 that was not the right choice, because he did not find an army to defend the regime, with the exception of a few brigades, you know. Then you have the Revolutionary Guards. You have what's called the People's Guards, Haras al-Shaabi. So different layers of security apparatus, those are who are loyal to the regime. But in terms of state institutions, well established, run by law, that doesn't exist, you know. Mm-hmm. Therefore, we discovered that we are unique compared to the Egyptian case and to the Tunisian case.
Yeah.
And that's why the Tunisians sat around the table and they managed to reach sort of consensus.
Yeah.
Why? Because early in the game, Bourguiba, even during the early 50s, the sense of law and the sense of institution became well ingrained, well established in the conscience of the Tunisian citizen. In Libya, that's not the case.
Right.
Because he did not achieve in Libya any sense of national integration, when the state disappeared, the people came to their lower or sub-loyalties, loyalty to a tribe, loyalty to a city, loyalty to a region.
Yeah.
And when you have arms in your gun, the situation becomes more complicated, you know. And this is the Libyan case today, you know, tribes, cities, militia affiliated with this tribe, another militia affiliated with this region. Some militias are ideologically oriented, those Islamists.
So if a Libyan were to walk in the room, what would that person's political identity be? Would the person first describe his tribe, maybe his region? Would he get to saying, well, actually, I'm a Libyan, or would that be a geographic identity? Or would being a Libyan, is there still a notion of a civil identity as a Libyan? Or would he just not mention Libya at all, as he describes his tribe, his region, his religion, etc.?
Well, it's quite interesting to compare the Libyans, how they perceive themselves during the uprising of 2011. Nobody was talking about tribe or region. They talk as Libyans. Uh-huh. And their sole purpose and cause was how to bring Gaddafi down. So that was a unifying force, you know.
So anti-Gaddafiism is to be a Libyan?
Yes. Yes, at that point, all Libyans were unified around one objective, how to bring this down.
Yeah.
And they all were talking about Libya. Yeah. People flew through Tunisia, from Zawiya, from Zintan, from the western part, which was under Gaddafi. They flew to the eastern part, which was under the NTC, just to take part in the process of liberating Libya.
Yeah.
That was not regional or tribal think.
Ah, so it wasn't east versus west, because a lot of Westerners moved over to the east to participate.
Yes, but it was not east-west thing at all, you know. Now it becomes like that. Simply because even the Skhirat agreement, unfortunately, made things worse, because they talked about what's called the Muhasasa between the three old provinces in Libya, Fezzan in the south, Tripoli in the west, and Cyrenaica or Barqa in the east. So Skhirat agreement, this presidential council they formed, they say three from the east, three from the west, as if they are making the partition of Libya as a fact.
I see.
And this is worse, because we should not talk about Fezzan and Tripoli, we should talk about Libya, because the partition of Libya will not serve any smaller entity, whether it's Tripoli or Benghazi or Fezzan, because actually you are dividing the natural resources which are needed for the development process. You need a critical mass to start any development, you know. By dividing those resources and spreading them out, you will not need, will not have any enough critical mass to start any development in any part of the country, you know. Unfortunately, the United Nations and the international community are pushing hard in this direction, as if the partition of Libya becomes an objective of the international community, and this is scary, you know.
So the United Nations unwittingly, really, is creating a circumstance where these tribal identities are reinforced.
Yes, that's
and
true.
And so this is, and by the way, you're being polite in saying the UN, because the UN isn't a thing, it's a collection of countries who participate through the UN. So indirectly, you're referring to Europeans, Americans, et cetera, who have kind of misidentified how to put Libya back together.
I think you are right.
Yeah.
I think you are right.
Well, I'll tell you why I'm right, because I was in Iraq. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of that similar type of thinking. Mm-hmm. Because you see the armed combatants and you think, all right, I got to stop the war, which is a good cause. Mm-hmm. But in stopping the war, you can end up solidifying the lines in ways that you don't want to do. Mm-hmm. So I assume then that you feel there is a chance to inculcate again this notion of Libya and this notion of being Libyan. But because I don't have the sense that it will be there for that long unless people start working on that.
I think there is an opportunity now, because as I said in my earlier remarks, it's for the first time in the last 5 years that everybody in Libya came to the realization that force doesn't pay.
Right. Right.
People started looking after the future of their kids.
Yeah.
They want to secure a future for their kids. Yeah. This is an opportunity, because people, in terms of attitude, they are ready now to sit around the table to find a solution.
Yeah.
Even the militia leaders are looking for exit for themselves.
Yeah.
They feel that they are stuck. They're looking for exemption, amnesty, what type of crimes they have committed during those 5 years.
Yeah.
They want to keep some of this wealth accumulated because of their misdoing in terms of all types of illegal trade which is being committed. And they need to be recognized in Libyan society. They don't want people to forget about them. So if you grant them those three objectives or those three concerns, I think they are in.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, does Libya have traditional allies? I mean, would Does Egypt now have a stake in seeing Libya as a unitary country? Does Morocco have a stake in making sure Libya survives, or is it the opposite? So how does the regional alliances shape up for you?
Well, I would say regional alliances are not shaping up, and international alliances are not shaping up either, you know, because at the regional level, I cannot see any coherent regional interest in Libya. There is some sort of disagreement between Algeria and Egypt. Mm-hmm. And there is a disagreement between Algeria and Morocco. There is a disagreement between Qatar and the Emirates.
Yeah.
And this is all set in the Libyan soil. This reminds you of the Lebanese Civil War, where Arab politics and Arab disagreements were set in Lebanese soil. This lasted for 15 years. When you come to the international level, the European, for instance, you would discover that France is on a side, and the British and the Americans on another side. The Italians are swinging here and there, sometimes with this camp and with this camp.
I'm shocked. Yeah.
So this has exacerbated the situation even worse. I wish that the international community, whether regional or international, has a unified, coherent interest in Libya. There would be a common language. But this is not the case. The problem is that those differences and those interests are pursued differently and ended up siding with this party in the conflict of that party, which has resulted in prolonging the agony and misery of the Libyan people.
Yeah.
I was saying this morning in a different gathering, either we do things right as an international community, or we don't do things at all, because sometimes we make things worse.
Yes, I've seen that happen now and again. So really, you don't have regional countries that necessarily can come together around the right strategy. The international community, I mean, looking to the Europeans and the Americans, is also a little, it's simply for us a matter of bandwidth. Do we have the time to put the intellectual power into thinking what the right solution is? It sounds like it's going to end up in your hands, that is, the Libyans' hands, to figure out what you want to do.
I think as long as the Libyans continue to rely on foreign players,
yeah,
and they're dealing with each other,
yeah,
the crisis is going to continue. It might even worsen. You
yeah
know? I think the solution is in the hands of the Libyans themselves. Yeah. You know.
Tell me about this emergence of ISIS in Libya. I mean, is this a very much of a foreign entity that is taking advantage of economic desperation? Are there religious elements in Libya who are inspired by ISIS? What are the dynamics of this growing ISIS presence in the past year or two?
Well, ISIS started probably early last year, you know, to yeah surface in the Libyan scene, you know. And it started in certain particular. There were some reports that the early formation of ISIS was from some of the followers of the previous regime, as the case in Iraq, you know. Yeah. And then it was joined by foreign elements. So today we have the United Nations of ISIS in Libya. We have all nationalities, you know, you name
yeah
it.
Yeah.
So they are in Libyan soil. The question, Mr. Ambassador, is why ISIS was allowed to exist in Libya? I mean, as I said this morning, to my knowledge, ISIS, they do not manufacture their weapons and they don't have their own banks. So there must be somebody who's financing them. There must be somebody who's supplying them with arms, you know. And I think intelligence circles of all Western societies and even regional countries, they know exactly who's the source of financing ISIS,
yeah,
who's the source of supplying them with arms. So why don't we talk about that openly if we are really sincere about fighting ISIS?
Yeah.
This is not happening.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. And it has to. I think. I'm going to ask one more question about these regional friends or enemies, and then I think we're going to go to audience questions. All right, let's say you have a group of Libyans in a coffee house, and there's a television on, and the television shows a football match between Algeria and Morocco. Who do the Libyans want to see win that football match?
Well, I would say that Libyans will side with the team that they don't want to face in the next round, you know, as Libyans do.
Okay, I won't try to develop that further. All right, let's have Professor Nader Hashmi come on up.
One of the privileges of moderating a question and answer session is that I get to ask the first question, and then I'll turn it over to you. So, Dr. Jibril, one of the big debates we're having in this country is over the question of foreign intervention, U.S. intervention. The Iraq war hangs very large over this country. Afghanistan, we're debating the question of Syria. Take us back to the early days of the Libyan uprising and revolution, and let's walk through a hypothetical scenario of what could have happened and should have happened. In other words, what should have the international community have done after Gaddafi was toppled that perhaps would have set Libya on a better track than it's on right now? So what are the lessons of the Libya intervention? And if we could roll the clock back and pursue policies that were better for Libya and obviously better for the rest of the world, what would those policies be post the demise of Gaddafi?
Okay, I have to say three things, and I have to be very candid here. First, the international community intervention in 2011 was needed because a massacre was looming ahead, you know. And the international community intervened based, was done based on UN resolutions. Mm-hmm. So it was within the international legitimacy as represented by the UN. The pretext offered at that point was the protection of civilians. My own opinion, many countries intervened to settle scores with Gaddafi. Mm-hmm. It's my own understanding. Nevertheless, we in Libya, we take an opportunity of that to protect ourselves, you know. So there is some sort of marriage of convenience here. But after the demise of Gaddafi, I remember President Obama said, our worst mistake, we did not think of the day after. Mm-hmm. I would say that there was a preparation for the day after. We in the NTC, we had a plan for the stability of Libya for the next 3 months after the fall of the regime. And that plan was reviewed by the United Nations three times. We did rehearsal with the bridge two times. One rehearsal was witnessed by the late Christopher Stevens. So the international community knew that there was a plan for the day after.
Well, what was that plan?
The plan is how to, first of all, second layer of the bureaucracy should not be removed.
Right.
So the institutions will continue running. Two, we had an emergency plan for the oil sector, for hospitals, for schools, for financial circles, the banks, even fire stations. So every aspect of life in the capital was taken care of with that plan. And we did rehearsal for that. We have, to give you an example, the third day of our entrance to Tripoli, there was a water supply cut of what's called the man-made river, you know. It was this stabilization team who went to Jabal Hassan in the south to fix this problem. So there was a plan, and there was a team for that plan. The problem is that this team was not enabled.
Militarily.
Militarily, because there was another group preparing to take over all the government institution the day the regime fell down. And that's the Islamists. So the problem started there. This is the first remark. The second remark, even with the absence of a state in our lives in Libya, we went through elections. And the National Forces Alliance, the party that I'm heading, won landslide in Libya. And it was against the expectation of everybody internationally originally, because the Muslim Brotherhood swept the elections in Egypt, they are in power. They swept elections in Tunisia, they are in power, and they are in Morocco. And Libya was the exception. And doing that was a miracle, because in Libya there was no party history. Mm-hmm. Gaddafi banned parties, you know, there were no parties. The Muslim Brotherhood was established in 1928 as a movement. And as a party, it was well organized, well financed, and they were ready to take over, and they think that they had it all, you know. We on the other side call us liberals, call us Democrats, call us what you want to call us. We thought that by using the concept of power of weakness, we can stand against this train coming so fast from Egypt and from Tunisia. So I visited around 38 cities in Libya, talking to the people, trying to bring those weak people, those weak entities together. And we collected them in one entity just to get into the elections together. And we did it because we didn't talk about politics. We didn't talk about ideology. We talked about development, mm-hmm. which touches in every Libyan home. Talked about education, medical services, finding jobs for the people. And this is what mattered for the Libyan citizen. Libyans are fed up with ideology for 42 years. They've been taught the Green Book for 42 years. Mm-hmm. They are eager and thirsty to have real infrastructure in the country, to have real education in the country, to have real medical services in the country. All these aspects of development were totally absent from the Libyan scene. And that's what we tackled. When we won the elections, we were not allowed to form the government by force, by the militias. And the international community didn't say a word about it.
So you're saying that the international community should have supported with greater military support, financial support, the forces that had won the election to establish political control?
Or at least issue a statement saying, hey, this is wrong.
Okay.
Even this statement did not come right. out from any regional country or a Western country. Right.
I think it's the point that Dr. Jibril has been developing, which is we accepted the notion of militia groups as the sort of building blocks of a rebuilt society. And I think that is the original sin.
Sin, yeah. That we need to learn from. Okay, let's turn the floor over to the audience, and I see Ahmed's
mic up first. The mic is actually here.
Okay,
so we're
going to
take
up.
Questions yeah, from this position
and
right
please
here.
Please line up behind the microphone, and please, you know, make a question, not a speech, and we'll get to as many of them as we can.
Thank you very much. Very quickly, Prime Minister Jibril, I'm just asking you on your evaluation or your take on General Haftar, and if you think he's able to change any reality in the Libyan scenario. Do you think he's able to craft a new scenario for Libya? And maybe connected to this, like, how do you evaluate the Egyptian role in Libya? Given that from an Egyptian perspective, General Haftar is the only guy who's able to kick ISIS off and to finish them off. And from the Egyptian perspective, he's able to secure the western borders of Egypt. So how do you evaluate?
Well, you answered the question.
No, I didn't. I'm asking on your
for
own
the Egyptians. For the Egyptians, Haftar is an asset, you know.
Could you tell the audience just who General Haftar is, so we're all on the same page?
And then what General the Haftar is, think of Haftar,
and then what the
Egyptians
think of.
He's the general commander of the army, appointed by the parliament. The parliament is the only legitimate institution in the country because it's the only institution voted for by the Libyan people, you know. So the parliament appointed General Haftar as the commander, the general commander of the economy, of the military.
And in your estimation, how much support would you say that he has?
Oh, he has tremendous support, especially in the eastern part of the country, okay. because he managed to restore some sense of stability in Benghazi, at least. Okay. Just before Haftar started his own military operation, we have about 580 cases of assassination against military officers, mm-hmm. against journalists, against media professions, and nobody raised a finger, you know. So he started basically defending themselves as an army people. Mm-hmm. They are defending themselves.
And the follow-up question that he had was the role of Egypt. What role is Egypt playing in Libya today?
Haftar's fighting terrorism, and most of the terrorist elements in Benghazi, they are associated with the Islamic brand as an extremist. Ansar al-Sharia, Daesh, they formed what's called Majlis Shura al-Thuwar in Benghazi. All these, this is Islamic brand of terrorism, you know. Egypt, after Sisi, and after what the stand they took against the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, it's in their vested national interest not to have the eastern part, at least, of the country, if not all of Libya, as a source of coming back of the Muslim Brotherhood into the scene again in Egypt. And I would say, this is just speculation, that this huge amount of weapons in Libya, now it's over 32 million pieces of weapons in Libya, which is more than enough to arm more than 7 armies. This is not for Libya. The ultimate objective, I would say, is Egypt. Because in terms of balance of power in the region, Libya is nothing compared to Egypt. Egypt is the crux of the matter. If you hit the head, the rest of the body is dead. So I think their own objective is Egypt. The ultimate objective of the Islamists is Egypt. And that's why I think the Egyptians are backing so strongly General Haftar, so not to allow this Islamic brand to come back to Egypt.
Great. Next question, Micheline.
Interesting.
Thank you very much for your talk. I think you partly responded to one question, but I would like to push it a little bit. So I have two questions. First is that I read in the press that there are conversations regarding the centralizations of the military in Libya. I also read in the press that there are discussions about the reallocations of the national oil corporations in fairly way. I think Mustafa Sanalla mentioned that recently. All those are very positive trends. To what extent do you think that they are credible? That's number one. And second, since we are under the umbrella of the Pardee Center, I'm going to ask sort of a bit more futuristic question. To what extent do you think we can move from this place to the next one, which everybody wants, this is stability, democracy? Is there a middle space that you could consider or envision, sort of a safe haven that is not in the east and is not on the west and is not in the south? I mean, people have been doing those conversations regarding Syria, some even about Yemen. The question is, would there be a possibility to reconsider Libya where the Libyan could actually focus on a site in which a hub, which could ultimately replenish economically the rest of the country. It could also be perhaps secured by a military presence. We know that the Europeans have been bombing Sirte and ISIS. So that could be a smaller project than the bigger national building project. So sort of throwing this futuristic idea and throwing the dice, could answer that.
Regarding the first question, I think probably you heard the unification of the NOC took place 2 days ago, you know. And I think this was a very quick move by Mustafa Sanalla and his counterpart in the eastern part of the country.
The NOC being the oil company.
That's right? The National Oil Corporation, you know. They unified the National Oil Corporation and they started immediately pumping oil. The first shipment was shipped yesterday. And this is a very welcome event by Libyans who've been deprived of their salaries for over 10 months now because there is a lack of complete financial resources in the government because of the UN embargo in Libya. Our assets are frozen. So we are a rich country, but we don't have money. That's the irony. So we are rich theoretically, you know, but we don't have access to our frozen assets, you know. Anyhow, this event was a capitalization of that move by General Haftar, you know. That's why his popularity has been beefed up substantially because of this move. And this is ironically against the wish of the international community who issued a statement deploring the action of Haftar. So that's why I'm saying you can play the role of a leader, but that role can be legitimate and more effective if it's from the within the perspective of the Libyan people or the people of the country, whatever country it is, you know. The second question about the future and Libya, I think Libya can be a model, you know, honestly, you know, because we have it all in Libya, in terms of a diversified base of resources, whether renewable energy, whether it's a beautiful coast of more than 976 miles, kilometers. We have oases in the desert. We have those historical sites, whether it's Roman, whether it's... this is unbelievable. It's a touristic spot. It's a renewable energy spot. We have the oil. We have the natural resources. We have the skilled, the qualified persons of people who got educated in the States, got educated in Europe. So we have it all. All we need is a peace of mind and people who trust each other and like their country. But we can do it in no time because technology today makes things fast, cheaper, in no time. And we can capitalize on the mistakes which have been committed by some Gulf countries. Libya, I think, can be the hub of the future. I always claim that the story of progress throughout history is a function of interaction between three elements, a triangle. It's population, knowledge or technology, and capital. If you have population and money without having the knowledge, you end up wasting your money, wasting your wealth. And this is the case of Libya for 42 years. And if you have population and knowledge, you can create wealth. This is the case of Singapore, the case of South Korea, you name it. The question is not money, it's knowledge. In today's age, the moment you have knowledge and you employ it and use it the right way, you can create miracles on the ground.
Next question.
Thank you very much. So I really appreciated the emphasis that you put on thinking very far ahead into the future and having that impact current policies. And then you also mentioned that natural resources have driven a lot of the fighting in Libya currently. So my question is, looking even as far ahead, maybe as to 2050, which you're trying to anticipate demographically, do you see climate change as interacting with Libya's issues? And do you think that the Libyan people have any perception of that, or are they focused on other more pressing problems right now? Thank you.
Well, the Libyan people today and the situation they are in right now, the first priority concern is security. They are concerned about the security of their kids. They are concerned about whether they can get a salary to feed up their kids or not. This is their utmost concern right now, you know. They're not concerned about politics. They're not concerned about the climate change or the environment. These are luxurious concerns for them right now. All they are concerned about how to get fed and how to get secured, how he can get back home without being arrested by militia, and that militia is asking for a ransom for his release. You know, or his kid is going to school, might be kidnapped by any militia. That's really concerning, you know, because there's a total lack of security in the capital today and the vicinity of the capital.
Next question.
Thank you, Prime Minister. I think one of the unfortunate things about Westerners' dispositions to the Middle East is our often goldfish-like attention span in keeping track of this and that conflict. So one thing I'm curious about is there's been a lot in the press recently about living conditions in conflict zones in Syria and Yemen, but I don't think you quite see as much press coverage of what living standards are like for the typical Libyan today in comparison with 2011. You mentioned that the Gaddafi regime didn't do a good job of developing health and education standards during his reign. But that being said, how do you think the lives of the average Libyan has changed since the uprising? And is there a variation among different regions under like different militia groups in that sense? Or has there been like a uniform decrease or increase in living standards?
Well, I think this comparison is widespread in Libya today, you know, comparing the period before 2011 and after 2011, and many people started to give some legitimacy to the previous regime out as a reaction to what's taking place right now. They are saying we were better off during Gaddafi years, you know. The legitimacy of any regime should be derived from its own achievements, not from the misdoings of others, you know. I think Gaddafi regime, in terms of legitimacy, should stand in its own record, not because of the misconduct of some militias after the fall of the Gaddafi regime. And the comparison is not really fair, because Gaddafi had a regime with its economic identity, with its social identity, with his political identity. Whether you agree or with it or not, it's not the case, you know. But what we have now is no regime. There was an uprising that lasted for 8 months, but ended up in a total anarchy, total chaos. I don't have a regime with well-defined policies economically, politically, foreign policy, social policy, so I can compare it with Gaddafi years. What we have is total anarchy. So you cannot compare a non-regime with a regime, you know. I wish we can reach the stage today to establish a regime. At that point, we can't compare it with Gaddafi years, you know. So I think the comparison is not fair at all, you know.
Okay, before the next question is posed, I ask no one else get up and stand in line. In the interest of time, we'd like to just wrap up with the last person standing in line. So next question, please.
Hi, my name is Faris. I'm from Saudi Arabia, so I'm one of those who were really happy when Arab Spring started. Really sad to see that our leaders, like to ask for our freedom, they should ask for international help. And we can see like what happened in Egypt and what happened in Tunisia as a cases, that there is no international help and they get what they want, while in Libya and Syria, we see international help and we see what's going on right there. So, and just my question, you have mentioned the absence of an institution in Libya made like Libyan situation complicated. I just want to ask you, like, what about the absence of civil society in Libya? Like, does it make the people, doesn't see the difference between the government and the states? So that lead it to what it is right now. And thank you.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think civil society in terms of well-organized institutions in Libya, NGOs, or all types of civil societies, were not allowed during Gaddafi years, you know. And if some of them existed, they existed under the banner of Gaddafi or the banner of his son, because he had an organization called Al-Gaddafi, or his daughter. Those two, his daughter and his son, had some NGOs, you know. But in the large context of the Libyan society, there wasn't any civil society organizations, you know. Civil society, for me, is a culture before its structure, you know. Even the rest of the Arab world countries, there are civil society organizations in Egypt, in Tunisia, in the Sudan, Morocco, in Jordan, in Syria, in Lebanon. It's full of civil society organizations, NGOs, you know. Yeah. But their priorities are totally dictated by how much fund is allocated in the European Union or UNDP. The fund is allocated, for instance, for gender analysis. And you are in a remote village in the Said of Masr in Upper Egypt, where they don't have a clean water, you know. That's the priority. So they start talking about gender because there is a fund allocated for gender. We don't have the culture of civility yet developed in the Arab world, so we talk about civil society organization. The structure is there, but the content is not there, you know. And that's why foreign fund, foreign resources of funding civil society organizations became even a source of penetrating the society and having some inside information about each single spot in each country of the Arab world, you know, under the banner and umbrella of civil society organizations. It's not a natural development of Arab culture and Arab civility. It became as resemblance of what's taking place in the West. Mm-hmm. So we have our NGOs. And I think has to be some stop there. The civil society culture, civil society organization should be revisited in that context.
Next question.
I so appreciated your candidness about your country, because we had the adventurous experience of the bridge as well in the early 70s between King Idris and General Muammar Gaddafi. So yes, that Libya is definitely a bridge. And I am simply delighted to hear a Libyan, because previous to Libya, we had lived in South America and in another country in the Middle East, and I had lots of interfacing. I was desperate with questions and interfacing with a Libyan, but it didn't happen.
Ma'am, you're restricted to one question.
Pardon?
One question, please.
Oh, see, I never want to let you go, because I have years of questions that have been in my heart about
you. Pick one.
I can't stop. Well, number one, I just want to say it is so interesting. You know, people scuba dived in this beautiful Med, finding Roman coins, Roman baths that had fallen into the Med because of your Septimius Severus, the Roman emperor.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, who knew? Mm-hmm. And it's fabulous. Mm-hmm. But I want to know if people living in the Middle East, Libya as well, can they visit Israel now? We could not.
Okay. So you were assigned in Libya some time ago, and you were very aware of the issue with Gaddafi coming up, and you know, during that transition, but you remember times when the tourist industry was well developed and.
No.
Oh, okay.
No, it was very difficult. It was very difficult. It was the most difficult in all of our five continents because of General Gaddafi.
I see. Okay. I see.
But I could see the possibility with Sabratha, with Leptis Magna. I was, and when the USIS and USIA used to go in, my heart was full of this beautiful country. And I want to know, and I didn't hear you answer my question, about going into Israel now. Is
Thank
it possible
you,
to live
okay,
in the Middle
East? We got the question. Thank you. You can come and chat with him afterwards, but we'll take that one question you posed and get him to answer it.
I've got so many. I want you to sit there forever.
I'm sure you do. Go ahead.
She's a fan.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you, man. Thank you.
I'll try to keep it a bit more brief, but...
Hold on. Let him answer the question about can Libyans visit Israel either now or perhaps in the future? I think that's the question. Your question was about the possibility or the potential of Libyan citizens visiting Israel. Is that correct?
No, that's not correct.
Can expatriates
living in Libya, they visit Israel now? Can expatriates. Western expatriates.
I think they can.
Yeah.
I don't think there is a problem with any expatriate if you want to visit Israel. The problem for Libyans, because the secret of the Arab League decision of boycotting Israel, that no Libyan is allowed to visit Israel, despite the fact that Gaddafi, during late 80s, as I remember, a group of pilgrims who were supposed to go to the pilgrim in Saudi Arabia, they have been diverted to Jerusalem. And they visited Jerusalem. And this is during Gaddafi years.
But it sounds like you had a tourism industry there before Gaddafi. You had Westerners visiting.
I think Libya until 31st of August 1969, there were clear bases for state institutions well established.
Yeah.
We had parliament with two chambers. We have free press, even private press. We have infrastructure which started to surface, though we discovered oil in 1959, and the first shipment was, I think, exported 1965. So only 3 years we started enjoying the oil wealth, and Gaddafi took over.
Yeah.
It's a total reverse, you know, the course of history.
Last question.
So a lot of countries respond to, like, instant gratification when it comes to foreign relations, whether that typically economically. So how do you think that when it comes to the issue of Libya, that you can bring its attention to people in the international community enough to, like, push policies that would allow for the development of a forum in Libya without the domination of Libyan resources later on?
I'm not sure if I understand the question.
Could you rephrase that? I'm not clear what the question exactly is either.
I suppose I'm just saying, like, how do you think that you can get people to become, like, policies tend to be influenced by what people are interested in. So how can you bring that to the people of the United States without there being, or even any other Western country, without there being necessarily, like, the desire to, like, over-dominate the vast resources available in Libya?
So I guess, correct me if I'm wrong, how can we get the people in the United States to encourage their government to pursue policies toward Libya that don't include a domination of Libyan natural resources, but actually help the Libyan people in terms of their development needs?
Yes.
Okay, thank you for rephrasing that.
That's my job.
Well, I think there are three issues, you know. The first issue, there should be a very ambitious plan where different players, whether in Europe or the United States, can see their vested interest in taking part in that plan. That's foreign investment, you know. By having very ambitious projects in Libya, that the payoff of those projects will be reflecting on everybody, not only on Libyans. You know. So we can see some interest in having Libya stabilized. Two, if Libya doesn't get stabilized, terrorism will spread to European shores. So either fear or potential investment, both aspects will be drawing the attention of the international community. Three is the future. Will Libya be a barrier of development, or will Libya will be the gate through which illegal immigration or refugees will be wave after wave coming to European shores? These are the three issues that should be addressed to attract the attention of every international player. Having said that, if you look at the European economy today, Libya can be a spot where Egypt, Tunisia, and Morocco, and even Algeria, can join hands with Libyans, and Europe will be relieved from its economic assistance to Egypt, to Tunis, and to Morocco. The United States is giving about $3 billion after Camp David to Egypt. This can be relieved from the European economy if Libya becomes the hub of investment for the future, you know. And it's there, the potential is there.
Okay, so let me just end on one final question, which I think is relevant to this topic and to where we are today as a country. As you know, Dr. Jibril, we're in the middle of a presidential election, and the results will be known in early November. If you had the chance to sit down and have a conversation with the next president of the United States, what would you ask from her?
That's a good one.
and specifically, what could the next administration do in terms of U.S. foreign policy with as much specificity as possible to help Libya out of its current turmoil?
Well, first thing I would tell her that let us pursue what we agreed upon about the future of the Libyan people when we met first, 14th of March, 2011. Because there was a clear mutual understanding and full support for those Libyan aspirations at that point. You know.
Remind us of those, since some of us may have forgotten.
We're talking about a roadmap, stabilizing the country, no exclusion for anybody, inclusive political process, state of law, equal rights for everybody, a huge role for women. So there was a very ambitious plan, you know, to create a hub of a civil society, of a democratic process going on mm-hmm. in North Africa.
You know, I don't think anyone in the United States would disagree with that. But specifically, what would you like to see the United States do in the next administration?
The United States should stand by the forces of change, the forces of civility in Libya, because the forces of darkness will affect the life of everybody, not only in Libya, but in the whole region.
Okay, well, on that note, let me thank everyone for coming. Thank the Prime Minister, and thank you for your questions.
Very good. Thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador. Thank you.